Thank you for joining us for our first ever Rome School at Home. Today, join Dr. Nora Heimann as she takes us on a tour of the Abbey of Saint-Germain-des-Prés.
My name's Nora Heimann, and I'm the chair of the Department of Art at the Catholic University of America. And today I want to invite you on a tour, a virtual tour, in which we're going to travel back both in space and in time. Where we're going to go is a charming neighborhood in Paris called the St Germain neighborhood. It's in the 6th arrondissement. Let's take a look at where we're headed. And make sure you've got your seatbelts buckled because we're about to take off. Here we go. So what we're looking at now is just a screen that gives you a sense of the places that you can go online to find out more information and to see a virtual tour in three dimensions and sometimes with sound as well. I particularly recommend Paris 3D Through the Ages. It's really pretty fabulous, but all of these are really rather wonderful. Where we're going to travel to next is a map of Paris in the past. We're going to just give you a sense of where we are by showing you if this is Paris, and the little red arrow that we're seeing here is an arrow, let's zoom in a little bit, an arrow that takes us between the distance between Notre Dame, which we're all perhaps familiar with. All points in France are measured by a particular brass marker in front of Notre Dame de Paris, the church. That's called in French point zero or point zero. And again, that's literally where all distances are measured from in France normally. And we're measuring the distance then, which is about 601 yards between Notre Dame and Saint Germain des Prés. What we're going to jump over now is a medieval abbey that was built on the site of Roman ruins. This is something that I was looking at in class with my students last week. But instead, we're going to jump ahead to the a map, a plan. It's actually sort of a view, if you can imagine a doll's house where you take the lid off. A doll's house where you're kind of peering into the top instead of peering into the side. That's what a plan is. We're looking at the top of the church, and we can see here a church and a courtyard and gardens. This is where an abbot would have lived with his abbey. And it was then surrounded by orchards and fields. Saint-Germain-des-Prés means the church of Saint Germain or Saint Germain in the fields. De Prés means in the fields. And what we're looking at here is a statue of King Chilbert in limestone. It's now in the Louvre Museum. It used to be between the two front doors. A trumeau is a statue built between two front doors of the refractory, which was where the sort of dining hall of the abbey. Chilbert founded it in the 500s. So we're talking early church. This was one of the first kings, Merovingian kings, who converted to Christianity and who supported it emphatically. This was just one of the churches that he helped to support, abbey and church. And after he died, to thank him for his patronage, they buried him there, and a number of kings got buried after him. So perhaps Catholic University could consider this as a fundraising effort. If you give money, you can be buried somewhere on the grounds, but I don't think that'll happen. Anyway, what we're looking at now is basically a map of Paris. This is a map that was produced around the year 1700, I believe, but it's portraying what they think it looked like in the 9th century. So we're looking at basically kind of fast forwarding about 400 years, and you can see that the abbey, I'm circling it right now with my mouse, the abbey had grown. It's still surrounded by fields. There's still the Boulevard Saint-Germain running right beside it. But you can see how close it is to the Seine River. And if you know anything about French history, you'll know that places that were on the Seine were both advantageous because that's how most goods and services and people were transported. River was the fastest way to transport things. It was kind of the modern superhighway for carrying goods. The downside of rivers, though, was that once the Norsemen, or what we now know as the Vikings, discovered that with their shallow draft boats, they could get into these wealthy cities. Paris was one of the great centers of Europe. They could come in and they could demand, sometimes literally not even have to do anything, just sort of say, you know, you have your choice. You can either give us all your valuables or we'll burn you down and take all your valuables. So sometimes people would just, abbeys might, for example, just hand over the gold chalice and paten and whatever, you know, treasury they had just to make them go away. But when they didn't cooperate at times, they were sacked and burned. And so what happens in the end is that the abbey gets rebuilt. By the time we step forward to the year 1687, which is the scene that we're looking at here, the abbey has been rebuilt in a brand new style with these tall towers, two towers over, one over each transept arm, one big tower over the front. This, the church that we're looking at here is, you know, the church that stands, and we're going to look at what it looks like today in just a moment. The church that's here is much closer to what we'll actually look at today than the church that existed in the year 500, 600, because for the most part that was largely destroyed. But if we turn to the church, which we're going to do in just a moment, what I'm doing here is showing you an image of Paris in an image of the neighborhood that St Germain-des-Prés is now. It is not surrounded by fields. Instead, it's surrounded by some of the great cafes for which Paris is known, Le Flore, oh my gosh, Dumago, some of the really best, most famous cafes are there, and it's still where both tourists go, but also Parisians go to sit on the terrasse and have a aperitif and enjoy the evening, or have a cup of coffee earlier in the day. What I'm showing you now is Saint Germain des Prés as it looks today, view from the south, which is the Boulevard Saint Germain, towards the church, and the tower, which is what we're seeing on the left-hand side of this photograph, is the oldest part of the church. That dates from the 11th century. Its vaults were completed in around 1050, and the chancel gets enlarged. And when all this work was done, it was consecrated by the Pope. But it wasn't really until around the year, 1200s, forgive me, I don't remember the precise year. It was in the 13th century, somewhere before the 1260s. So it was around the mid 13th century. One of the great architects of Paris, in fact, some people argue the first major mason or architect ever in Paris, resolved a problem that they'd been searching a solution for over 100 years, and that was how to build an enclosure over the vaulting of the roof in the back, over the altar and around the ambulatory. That's where pilgrims can walk around the exterior of the church. And there were pilgrim relics that they wanted, relics, holy relics there that pilgrims would have wanted to come visit and did. Here's another view of the church. We're now seeing it across the Boulevard Saint-Germain, and there is that beautiful old massing of the tower that was dates back to the 11th century. Much of the rest of the church that we're seeing is a combination of 17th century and actually 19th century, because the French Revolution really ravaged this church. It was very much a victim of destruction during the French Revolution. But we're imagining ourselves now approaching the building, trying to walk through the great portals in front, the tower, that beautiful aged tower, one of the oldest and largest pieces of medieval France that survive in Paris, and in fact that survive in this whole region. It's the tower is the largest early remaining structure from medieval Paris in terms of sheer mass. What we're seeing if we sort of imagine ourselves walking around the outside of the church is the beautiful flying buttresses that get put in the back. Or let's be honest, they're interesting flying buttresses. They're not nearly as beautiful as the kind of flying buttresses we're going to see if we just look at Notre Dame, or certainly look at a place like Sainte-Chapelle. But it's incredibly innovative. These are among the earliest flying buttresses that we'll see around the back of the church in a church in Paris or even in France at all. So what we're really seeing is the birth of the Gothic style. Now, what's the point of a flying buttress? The point of a buttress is it holds up the wall in case the wall might fall down. Now, why would a wall fall down? By the way, what I'm showing you here are just some ruins of a church, or actually ruins of a lady chapel, which was designed by Pierre de Montreuil, this great architect. who helped to build the over the ambulatory and then built a spectacular chapel that was completely destroyed in the revolution. Just fragments exist. And we're seeing some of those fragments in a park nearby. And we're seeing them cheek to jowl beside a sculpture by Picasso honoring the great poet Guillaume Apollinaire, who lived in the neighborhood. Anyway, and this there's this beautiful, interesting, wonderful YouTube link that you can click on and it'll take you on a virtual tour that I hope that they'll include this link with it, in which they've architects and modelers and archaeologists and art historians have reconstructed what it the church looks like, this chapel that was destroyed, from the fragments that exist. So here are the fragments, and the YouTube link here is to this really wonderful reconstruction of the church. But we're looking at a plan now. You can see the tower, and then these the flying buttresses are these kind of rounded apsidal shapes. They're supporting, basically, if we step inside the church, you can see the windows. Because windows, of course, aren't load-bearing. And for churches that are built out of stone, which they have stone vaults, there may be wooden beams up behind them between the rooftops and these wooden vaults, sorry, stone vaults inside. But the stone, for the most part, masonry, ashlar masonry is what is constructing the interior of these churches. And these massive windows require buttressing from the outside to hold the walls up and to keep the roof from falling in. So the other thing that I'm going to point out from the church, and we're about to end because I know this is meant to be a super fast tour, so I hope you've had your seatbelts on because we've gone really high speed. What we're looking at is the interior, both bits of the windows. All of those are modern windows. None of the medieval windows from this church survive. But we're also looking at the painting on the walls. Art historians call this polychromy. It means using multiple colors to paint the walls. All these frescoes are done in a kind of Gothic style because Gothic churches were almost to a one painted. Certainly the vaults were painted blue with gold stars to honor God and the Virgin Mary. That kind of color blue, azure blue, was the most expensive pigment you could buy to paint the whole ceiling with it, to make it look like heaven itself with golden stars made out of gold leaf, is the ultimate kind of homage you can pay. And it also dazzles the viewer. But the murals on the wall were all painted by a painter in 1840s, 50s, and 60s. His name was Hippolyte Flandrin. And Flandrin painted them along with a group of artists that assisted him, but he was the principal. So we're getting a beautiful view of the apse, the choir, the vaults, and the frescoes by Hippolyte Flandrin. And we're kind of walking around the space really quickly, looking at some of the 19th century churches, looking at the beautiful reconstructions of the capitals that are all meant to tell stories. So here we have the eagles. They have the different evangelical beasts, ox, eagle, man, and angel. And we're also seeing symbols, for example, of the miracle of the loaves and fishes, because of course we're seeing wheat fronds as well as fish, and a view of some of the decorations from the inside. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this incredibly fast trip. Perhaps you can come with me sometime to Paris. I'm really eager to take a group again. I brought many, many groups of both students and French, Catholic University alumni to France, and it would be great fun to do it again with you. But meanwhile, welcome to St Germain-des-Prés. And my name again is Dr. Nora Heimann, and if you've got any questions, don't hesitate to reach out to me. Welcome. Thank you for watching this.